Welcome to the Gray Area. The Gray Area Media. We've obligated ourselves to be the voice for all communities, speaking on topics that include community, religion, education, politics, technology, sports, health, and wellness. The Gray Area Media is a platform created by longtime friends for the sole purpose of providing our communities with the ability to voice current, past, and modern day issues. The Gray Area and its naming significance solely speaks to the area in which people shy away from speaking because of media-based constraints or contractual-based obligations. Well, I'm here to tell you, we don't do that here. So please, stay tuned in. We're going to go live in a few minutes. Don't forget, please add us as a friend on Facebook so that you can follow our live feed. And not only that, please add us on Twitter and Instagram at The Gray Area Media. Please visit our website at www.thegrayareamedialive.com. Thank you.
Hello, Facebook. We are live again. This is The Gray Area, and we are back at it again. This is Ray E.
Ebony.
Ebony is a co-host, and we got
Leslie House
in the building. Give it up for her first appearance on The Gray Area, y'all. She's been in the background hooking it up. And we have a special, wonderful guest today. Kendria Williams of Pitchfeast is joining us. And today, we are definitely going to focus on building businesses. Okay, there's so many different things out there that we just don't know. You know, none of us are experts. None of us really know everything about business, but we all have experiences. Everybody in this room has either experienced building a business or experienced dealing with business in some form or fashion. So today we're going to definitely assist you in helping you understand some of the things that come along with building a business. What I want to do first is allow Kendria to give us her special business. Don't give us your business model, but give us the details behind Pitchfeast, because I feel like this is something that everybody should want to be a part of if you're building a business. This is awesome that you're doing this. So please give the people a little bit of information about what you do.
Okay, real quick. Pitchfeast is a community crowdfunding event. We host a community dinner, and we invite entrepreneurs to come and pitch their idea. Our audience pays $10 to get into Pitchfeast.
Okay.
They get dinner. Sometimes we get beer.
There it is.
I know, right? And
any wine? You got any wine?
Sometimes we have
okay,
wine.
Okay, all right now. I'm there.
Hashtag looking for wine sponsors. They also get to vote. So they hear the ideas of the entrepreneurs who are pitching that night.
Mm-hmm.
They make the vote in terms of who they thought had the best idea.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And then the winner collects 75% of what we collect at the door.
Wow.
In admission. And then we have some other prizes, our services aligned to kind of get them through that first year.
Oh, wow.
What are some of those services and things that you guys assist them with in that first year?
So it's interesting you asked that. So the services that we have aligned are essentially what falls within what's considered a barrier area
okay.
for business success. And so office space is, of course,
yeah.
one area that right. businesses struggle in.
Okay.
Marketing assistance, legal oversight,
nice.
Mentoring, mm-hmm. networking opportunities, and then education.
Right.
And so we have partnered with different individuals or organizations who specialize in those certain areas.
Okay.
Nice.
So, for instance, the Speakeasy gives our Pitchfeast winners
mm-hmm.
6 months free access to their space.
Nice.
So Speakeasy is a co-working space that you basically can go in, set up, you can have meetings in, or you can just do your work.
Mm-hmm.
But it's a good place for you to get out and
right.
start mm-hmm. just doing those first steps of getting your business
right.
running and off the ground.
Right.
We also work with an attorney named Mike Head, who is
okay.
very instrumental in just business development, period.
Mm-hmm.
He has donated so many hours to our Pitchfeast winners, and he actually sits down with them and talks to them about their business structure
okay.
so they can make sure that when they are creating that structure, it is the right structure.
Okay.
Or if it's a partnership, it's the right partnership.
Right, right. Which is very important.
Extremely important, because sometimes some of the best partnerships fail. So.
Right, right. It happens all the time. A few friends of mine got into what they called a partnership. It really wasn't a paperwork made Absolutely. Sponsorship, and once the money started coming in, it kind of fell apart.
Absolutely.
So, I mean, you know, it's very important. I'm in the world of documentation, and I understand how important it is to have that that paper and that signature on there. Mm-hmm. It is very easy for someone who has a contract to go into a courtroom or go into some form of lawsuit and win, you know, because it was all signed upon.
That's right.
It only takes a couple of seconds to get done, you know what I'm saying? But it may take hours to go over and review that information. Be willing to do that. So, and I've seen it all. I mean, doing documentation, you kind of see the ins and outs of policies and procedures and things that happen that should and shouldn't happen. And if it ain't on that paper, it's a problem. Mm-hmm.
And so sometimes we have to be mindful, you know, some business owners come and they are very highly skilled, but when it comes to having that business acumen to make sure that business runs and stays functioning, that's kind of where you see the drop off. And so that's where you see partnerships break down because there wasn't a legitimate agreement in the first place, you know. They had a great idea.
Right.
They had great execution, but they didn't take that one step to have somebody look over like, hey, is this okay? You know, we're friends. Should we be going into business? You know, so it's just small things that seem like, okay, I really don't need to do that now. Turns out to something really huge.
Really big later
on. Like you said, when you stand in court.
Absolutely.
You're like, well,
and
wait
the judge
a minute.
Is looking over all the paperwork. And, well, you didn't write that in here. I mean, that document means everything when it comes to business. So, and anybody you do business with, you should have some form of documentation, you know, and the signature, just to make sure that things don't go south. See, that paper kind of keeps people at bay.
Right.
Yep.
You see, what it does is it makes sure that everybody's doing what they're supposed to be doing.
Absolutely.
And it says exactly
it's
what you do, exactly what I do.
It's a guideline.
So.
You can refer back to it.
Right.
You know, if there is any misunderstanding, let's go back. What does the paperwork say? So it's always good. I mean, regardless if it's a partnership agreement or a marketing plan, you always want to have things documented so you can go back to them so you can either see where you messed up or where you see, you know, this is where we need to keep going. So
So Pitchfeast, basically, you come have dinner.
Come have dinner.
And you network and mingle with other business owners.
Actually, it's interesting. Our audience is a diverse audience.
Okay.
So we do have some business owners, but then we have just some community members. We have students who come. We have professors who bring their students. We have parents who bring their kids.
Nice.
We have my children there.
So it's kid friendly. It's just kid friendly.
Absolutely.
Event.
Okay. Absolutely kid friendly. You know, so it is a mixture of individuals who are in the room, but I think they all have a common goal of just seeing great initiatives get started in the city. And so it's interesting with Pitchfeast. So we are kind of different than normal pitch competitions because we are not the only pitch competition. There are plenty of pitch competitions out here. But we are different because we accept all types of pitches. And so you could be a for-profit entity. You could be a non-profit entity.
Okay.
You could be a social project.
Right.
You know, if you have the desire to do something that's going to improve the Indianapolis ecosystem, then we encourage them to pitch it.
Nice.
You know, when I think of a social project, the first one that comes to mind is the Rivoli Street Project or Park Project. There was a neighborhood over on the Near East Side, and they had a they had developed this park and cleaned up this park, so the park looked really good.
Okay.
But then they had a highway overpass that just was not the prettiest thing to look at. And so they came to Pitchfeast. They pitched their idea. All they needed was the supplies.
Nice.
So an artist could come in and paint the mural.
Nice.
And so they actually won. And today the mural still stands.
Wow.
So it removed blight in the community. So
that's awesome.
You know, our platform is completely different than normal, you know, pitch platform.
Right.
Because our goal is just to get people started.
Right.
Now how, for this is actually a new concept for me. I've never heard of this before, and I think it's awesome.
Thank you.
So how would that look for people like me that have never heard of a pitch feast or any other concept similar? How would that look for someone, say, if I want to start a business, you know, and what should I do? What should I expect, you know, as I'm coming to a pitch feast?
So if if you were thinking about pitching at a pitch feast or even thinking about starting a business, the first thing I would encourage you to do is to just come to a pitch feast.
Okay.
Just check it out. The one common theme I get from people who attend pitch feasts is they like the energy in the room.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. I actually hate the word networking. Only because I think I was kind of exposed to it incorrectly.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So for the most part, you know, networking is you got this important person, he comes and stands and talks.
Oh, MLM.
So I did not understand networking. Mm-hmm. Networking, true networking is when two people meet, they find out their synergy, mm-hmm. and there's a collaboration that's made in the room.
Right.
And so that's what Pitch Feast ends up being. Mm-hmm. And so a lot of people love the energy.
Mm-hmm.
And then they understand that our pitchers come from all different types.
Mm-hmm.
And so you might have somebody who's seasoned, and you might have somebody who is scared to death.
Mm-hmm.
So I would encourage you to come to Pitch Feast and check out the atmosphere. And then if you like it, you can go to our website, www.pitchfeast.org, and fill out a proposal, and we'll let you pitch.
Okay.
That is pretty awesome. Mm-hmm. That is awesome. I mean, like Ebony, I've never heard anything like that, especially in the Indianapolis market.
Right.
And that's why I'm glad that you're on here today, so that we can let more and more people know about this. There's nothing being done like that here that I know of.
Well, thank you. I appreciate the support. Absolutely.
Mm-hmm. One thing I want to address in the business scene that I've seen happen a lot more is you have your standard businesses, right? You have those businesses that's been around for a long time. They're making profit, whether you know they got bad or good customers. And then you have smaller businesses that are trying to grow, and a bad customer can really, really, really affect them in a bad way. What are some of the things? What are some of the things? Because I think the problem is that some of these businesses don't hold themselves accountable or to the higher standard that the best businesses do. You know, which I'm in the beginning, it's all about customer service, right? I mean, whether that customer is a D-I-C-K or what, you still have to make sure that you tend to them and make sure that they're okay. Because that one customer, especially when you're a small business, could really put you under.
Absolutely.
You know, so, you know, a lot of people want to know if they're a small business, what are some of the things they can do to avoid those kind of situations? And, you know.
Oh, man. You're a documentation person, right?
Absolutely.
Policy and procedures.
Yep.
You know, you set the culture up front.
Mm-hmm.
You know? And, you know, surprisingly, a lot of businesses are one or two person owners.
Right.
You know, so it might be a husband and wife, it might be a mother and daughter, father and son. So if dad is kind of irrational, then the son might be a little irrational.
Right.
So, you know, sometimes we have to remember that, yes, our own, but we're still serving
other people.
Other people.
Absolutely.
And those are our bread and butter.
Right.
And sometimes we get real lax on having our little bread and butter right here that we don't stock up the storehouse.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you know what I'm saying? If our bread and butter runs out here, we don't have anything to fall back on.
Right.
Right.
So it's very, very, very instrumental in definitely creating policies and procedures that not only people follow, but if something happened to you, somebody should be able to come in and say, okay, dad was X, Y, and Z. Maybe I can keep this going.
Right.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. Right.
You know, that's the one thing I can pride myself on. I've probably killed a lot of trees, but if something happened to me, I got a little boy. I'm sure he can pick up.
You're running fine.
Moving.
That's awesome.
His feast is still going to happen.
That's awesome. That's awesome.
Now, he might jack that price up. But, you know, we have to, as a people, we have to understand that we are creating our own literature.
Mm-hmm.
And so we are creating the things that are being passed down.
Right.
And it might not be a published book. It might not be binded.
Mm-hmm.
But it is, you know, your step-by-step guide of how you created that business, how you got that customer.
Mm-hmm.
And so somebody can take that and pass it right down, and your business, your legacy is still around.
And it's important to follow those, you know, those things that you put in place.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. And there's a thin line in business, right? I mean, because you're going to have your irate people. You're going to have your people who just aren't pleased with anything, and no matter of what customer service level you give them, they just don't care, you know. So you're gonna meet those people, and mostly it's mental, because the normal person isn't going to be that irate, but you do have your people that are picky, and you have to understand how to deal with them. So, you know, some of those things that, I mean, and I've been doing a little bit of research, but some of those things have just bite the bullet, you know. You might have to give a refund. That's okay. Don't fight for that refund. That $5.25 that you got to give back might turn into a $1,000 lawsuit, and you'll wish that you gave them that $5.25 back. So, you know, we got to stop fighting with the customers.
And speaking of that,
let them have it.
Word of mouth travels way faster.
Yes, it does.
Twitter, absolutely. Facebook, yes. Instagram. I don't know about Snapchat.
Yes. And you know, they have
disappeared.
They got all of them out there.
But, so, and all it takes is one bad review.
Oh, yeah. And that's what I was going to say. They have reviews.
Absolutely.
Now.
Yep. I read reviews.
I do.
Before I buy anything,
I don't care.
I read at least 5 or 6 reviews. Yes. May even go longer. I just want to see and make sure that the product I'm buying, you know, it's good. So, you know, think about that. Somebody that's hot and volatile, well, I mean, that's probably all they do. They go from business to business, creating write-up to write-up, because they know that it's effective. So we have to take them serious. Leslie, go ahead. You had a question?
I had a question. You were talking about legacy, building a legacy. How did you come to building your legacy with Pitchfeast? How did you come to the idea of bringing this to the people?
Good question.
It is so interesting. Every time I tell this story. So I started off as a history major.
Okay.
I studied African American history. There was a time right after emancipation I was like really infatuated, like what happened. So I was kind of infatuated with Nat Turner too. That's a whole nother story. You've seen the slaves did things in patterns. So you've seen some of the slaves, they went and looked for their families, which made sense. Some slaves actually stayed with the plantation owner because the plantation owner was highly dependent on those slaves. So they stayed with the plantation owner. And then some slaves kind of started popping up shop and doing their own thing. So you've seen little communities pop up like Rosewood and, you know, stuff like that. But it had to invoke a fear. Because shortly after we became economically viable and independent, you started seeing the Jim Crow laws come into place. Trying to stop whatever. Interesting. If you've seen the 13th, you just want to strangle somebody. But they implemented, you know, they can keep you as a slave if you were a prisoner. If you look at Vanderbilt, when he built that entire railroad system, he built that off of prisoners, who were, of course, people who look like us, because we broke some insane law.
Okay.
So fast forward to now, about 2012-ish, I was in some research programs, and I was really trying to understand what can we do in terms of black unemployment. You know, like, we're applying for jobs. We can't. There's a certain amount of us that just cannot get a job.
Okay.
You know, and this is all my opinion, but, you know, to me, when the prisoners are in the prison system and they're getting a college degree, it's kind of like you're selling them a false hope. Because when they get out, the chance of them getting a job is still just as slim as if they didn't get it. And it's just, you know, but I realize we are a highly skilled person, people. So I started doing research in terms of, you know, what could be done. This is kind of how I understood what the barriers were of business success.
Okay.
So I was trying to understand how entrepreneurship could be used to combat black unemployment within certain groups.
Okay.
And so it went from the Center for Innovation and Minority Business to Dreamapolis, which I had some partners.
Okay. Dreamapolis, what is that?
It was our parent organization.
Okay.
That has since been dissolved. And then Pitchfeast Corporation is now the organization now.
Okay.
And Pitchfeast is the event.
Okay.
But, you know, where was I at now?
Legacy.
But, you know, just understanding, you know, entrepreneurship. I had a guy one time, and this dude, I mean, he was bad. He started with a lawnmower, you know, and he was really good at what he did, and he was trying to get some contract business, so like apartment complex.
Yeah.
So the apartment manager told him, he was like, "I'll give you a contract, but you just need to submit a proposal."
Nice.
So literally, dude wrote, "I will cut your grass for $400 a week." You know, signed it. Wow. Because he's like, "This is all I got."
Right.
So I sat down with him. We developed a really nice template. You know, outlined all the services that he would provide.
Mm-hmm.
You know, according to what he could do.
With a lawnmower.
Well, at this point, he started getting, you know,
more business.
Yeah, but he was able to take that proposal and get a contract which was equivalent to someone's income for the year.
Wow.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
Mm-hmm. So he got paid annually for that. That's another good tool right there, is getting contracts that last longer than a day or a week.
Right.
You know, get one that lasts for a year, because, I mean, that's automatic money. As long as you're doing what you got
to
do.
Somebody back to work. You got somebody back to work.
You're putting somebody back to work.
He's self-sufficient. You know what I'm saying?
Wow.
And then he started buying materials and equipment.
Right.
Last I know, he bought a big tree truck where he can cut trees down.
Mm-hmm.
So, and all this is debt-free.
Right.
Mm-hmm. You know, so here you are. You're highly skilled. You know, and you buy all this equipment. Now you have this equipment. You have no overhead.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Everything you make is yours.
I mean, right.
That's the American dream, if you ask me.
Absolutely.
Right.
You know, I think sometimes we glorify entrepreneurship and we want to quantify it as if you're not at the Bill Gates level, then you're not successful.
Right.
You
know, right.
But if you make enough income to satisfy or sustain your family and do what you need to do in life, you are a success.
That's right.
Absolutely. A friend of mine, Gio, John Roberson, that came on the show with SEPA, does security at different apartments and all over. I mean, working, training with the police departments, training their officers on how to be better officers. I mean, and this guy is from Camden, New Jersey. You know, ran into some early trouble. Came to Indianapolis, and with, you know, $1,600, built an 8 months later, $250,000 business. Now is I'm not going to say the number. I don't want to get nobody in trouble. But he's making very good money right now. And he was one of those people that, you know, where can I get a job?
Mm-hmm.
You know, he took it upon himself. He became a part of the solution.
And think about what this does for his children. You know,
absolutely. Set him up.
Set him up. Because you can train them, you know. Going back to legacy, because I forgot about that, girl.
No, we
know,
got you.
My sons, actually, my kids, they've all been to Pitchfeast. You know, they've marketed Pitchfeast. They've built a database for Pitchfeast.
That's beautiful.
You know, I keep them in my stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
You know, because this is what I do. So, you know, I need you to have that same skill, too. So if it doesn't work
kids?
Out. They range, baby. You don't. We ain't got all that.
Okay.
They range. Little children. But you know, they just, you know, teaching them skills that, you know, even when I'm just posting an event on Facebook, sometimes I ask my son to do it. You know.
Yeah.
Because these are things I do, and hopefully, when something happened to me, you know, he'd say, "Well, I can keep this going. My mom did this. I can keep this going."
Mm-hmm. Right, absolutely.
And it's something for him to be proud of. So,
yeah.
Keep
that legacy going.
You know, listen, when you look at the startup community here, we got a great startup community here.
Right.
And a lot of them have hired their own children.
Yeah, absolutely.
Wow.
Why not?
Why not?
You
why
know,
not?
Show them how to do it. Get them into business. Mm-hmm.
Get him in young.
A lot of that's free labor.
Exactly.
Is he going to take care of him anyway, right? Free labor.
So, yeah, I think one of the things we have to start thinking about is a succession plan, you know.
Yes.
Making that policy and procedure, documenting what you do, and having a succession plan.
Mm-hmm. Right, following through with that plan. Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Another thing I want to address, being a person that writes documentation, it's important to know what kinds of different documentation that you should have. Ebony's a writer as well. But there's so many different things. Thank you cards, follow-up cards, proposals, having PowerPoints. All these things are key to a business operations and how they deal with one another. and you sit in the office area with them and you see the paper amount of paperwork they exchange and the items they exchange, you'll soon know that what you're doing ain't nothing. I mean, I ran into that. I was doing web development for ex-WNBA player, Yolanda Moore, a very good friend of mine. She started doing public speaking. And, you know, she was the first client that I had that had requested all these different forms of documentation and things right along with her website. And I'm thinking to myself, I can do those, but I never thought of how necessary they were to business. Mm-hmm. So there was probably like 8 to 10 items on that list. And I'm like, okay, you can have all these. And she's like, okay, well, can you put them on a website? And I kid you not, 2 days later, she had booked 30 colleges to speak at.
Wow.
So what they did was they looked at a website. They looked at all the documentation and all the things that she had on there, because she, if you're competing with real people who do public speaking and big businesses, you got to have all these things. And that's when I first soon realized that, hey, I'm offering everybody that stuff.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? I learned my lesson from that, because I'm like, I was just doing web development, but there's so much more to it when you're dealing with different corporations. So we have to take those things into account, and we individually have a responsibility to offer those things to people.
Yeah.
So if you have a business and you know what somebody else could use to get further, let them know.
Right.
You know, it's up to them whether they buy that service from you, but we're obligated to let people know. Leslie.
Yes.
We've been doing a little bit of research, looking around, see what's going on out there. What are some of the things you've been finding to help businesses market themselves?
Well, I pretty much focused on the trends for this year.
Okay.
The biggest trends, of course, are with video, social media, even more so mobile.
Mobile.
They're seeing a great increase in consumers using mobile technology, video,
right,
as they're shopping.
Absolutely.
So they're
to shop. Nice.
And I personally do it all the time. I will stand in the store and I'll look at an item. I'll go online and find it at another store and compare prices. I might even look at reviews.
Right.
Maybe look at a video from YouTube to see what's going on with it.
I usually do the video before I get to the store.
Okay. Okay.
But once I get in the store, I'm pulling up stuff. I'm comparing prices and everything. I'm looking for coupons, coupon codes.
Absolutely.
So that's like a big increase that they're seeing online, and they're really pushing people to market, to make sure that their video content goes across both desktop and mobile.
Nice.
As well as utilizing Facebook Live,
like
we are here.
Absolutely.
They're saying that streaming is such a big thing.
Absolutely.
We're not really seeing a lot of marketing with streaming right now, but hopefully it's coming.
it's coming.
And then they also talked about Generation Z, I guess.
That's the generation after the millennials,
Yeah. And how...
They remind me of that movie, I forget what it's called, but it ends with Z, and it was like a bunch of zombies.
Yeah.
I hope that, you know, that wasn't the...
Well...
Well, we gonna, you know, it's our obligation to make sure that these kids don't become zombies.
Oh, well, you know, the thing they were saying with the Generation Z is Snapchat is a big thing because
absolutely
the post only lasts for a short period of time,
right?
And they're finding,
I think it was 24 hours. It used to be like a minute or something.
It's like 24
hours. Now it's like 24 hours.
Yeah. I gave up my Snapchat. But
I still don't understand.
I don't get it.
I need some
I'm
work.
I'm still getting used to Facebook.
Yeah.
I don't have an Instagram. I admit. I don't know Facebook yet.
They were saying the Generation Z, their attention span is like 8 seconds.
Right.
And so, I know, right?
Absolutely.
So, Snapchat is like something
that... And adults is not much further from that.
No, it's really not.
I'm about 11.
True. Which is weird because, you know, we didn't come up that way, but we've spent so much time online and everything. We've gotten that short attention span, too.
Absolutely.
So, you know, they're just talking about using the different platforms.
Yeah.
I was trying to think. What was another? We have Facebook, Instagram, Boomerang. I don't know what Boomerang is.
I don't know what Boomerang is either, but it sounds...
Oh, Boomerang is part of Gmail, so if you want to schedule an email or whatever, then you just schedule it in Boomerang and then send it later.
Oh, is that all that is?
Interesting.
Yeah. It's cool, but it starts getting annoying.
Okay. Notifications and stuff. Okay.
Okay.
All right. Well, there it is, folks. That's one of your key golden nuggets right there. Mm-hmm. Just know that if you want to start reaching out there, one of the new trends is to make sure that you are utilizing social media. Yep. Utilizing the internet for what it is, video and the whole nine. Mm-hmm. A lot of kids and people are making money off YouTube like crazy.
Oh, yes.
I mean, they're quantizing, utilizing the AdSense, Google AdSense, and they get paid cents per click.
And that's another trend. Using the influencers, that's what they're called.
Right.
The influencers to market your products because they already have a base that trusts them.
Right. Absolutely.
And if you have something positive to say about the product, followers are gonna go out and get it themselves.
Right. So. I did a another web development. I'm speaking from my experience because I find a different businesses. I've done all kinds of different businesses from a web developer perspective, and one was a friend of mine named Antonio Listenby, and him and his wife run Diamond Virgin Hair. That's local in the city, and one of the first websites I did for them. That was one of them, and they've gone on and did multiple and making good money right now. But one of the things that they utilized to get their business out there was YouTube. So and I was asking him, I'm like, dude, what are you doing to make money? You know, like, because he was moving fast and he took advantage of the internet. Mm-hmm. He took advantage of YouTube, found women who were doing the tutorials, you know, and decided to send them.
Yep.
Some product, and they market it for them.
That was the smartest
thing. And and they go to the. I mean, if you're looking at a tutorial and you want your hair just like the person on the tutorial, you're gonna go get the hair that she's using, right? So he's marketed his business that way, and he is doing phenomenal. So that is just a prime example that you know YouTube and the internet and utilizing your resources will get you even further.
And going back, like you said, he was willing to provide samples.
Mm-hmm.
Like,
absolutely.
You know, so many times I run into people and I was like, you know, you got to provide samples. Even if it is just food, you got to provide samples.
Right.
And the kickback, I mean, the pushback is...
What you get and after that, you know what I'm saying? You something that costs you $10, you're going to get $150 for just throwing that out there.
Especially when you're dealing with something that deals with taste or texture. Mm-hmm. People want to feel it and taste it.
Right. The experience.
Mike, that's it right there. It's all about that experience. Right. So if I eat some food at an event that I'm already feeling good about, and the food is good...
Yeah.
So my caterer, Jeremy over at Nameless Catering, that was the epitome when he started. He wasn't giving away food, but he paired up with certain nonprofits and provided that food in kind.
Yeah.
Where I was one of them. So what did I do every time I talked? Somebody asked me about a caterer. You know, I was telling them Nameless Catering.
Yep.
Every time I had a Pitchfeast event, Nameless Catering.
Goes far.
That providing a sample of what you have, that little bit of product that you provide up front is going, you'll get that back tenfold.
Word of mouth.
That's right.
So, word of mouth.
So with all the information that we have on media, social media, and I guess this is all interactive, like are we moving away from flyers?
Absolutely.
And pamphlets.
Absolutely. And this is when I knew flyers didn't work anymore. As an artist, okay, I'm not going to say they
people
don't
still
work,
use them.
But their impact is not as impactful as they were back then before phones and all that.
Uh-huh.
So, I mean, so really it's just become a part of, hey, I got a flyer. Hey, I got a business card. You do too. I got one too.
Oh
it just
God.
Makes you look more official.
Yeah.
You know, but I knew flyers was dying out in like 2006 when I ordered like 10,000 of them.
And they were $30.
And yeah.
Full color.
Yeah, full color. Double side. So, and I handed them things out all night for like 3 days, and I used to see them all throwing on the floor, on the ground, and nobody spent time. And not only that, once I got rid of all my flyers, I had like maybe 90 people come to the show. I was so mad because I was like, okay, I passed at least 10,000 flyers, so I know I'm gonna get at least 150.
You got 0.9%.
That's terrible. It was terrible. I lost money.
You know,
with my $30 flyer, I lost money.
So, like, digital flyers, you know, when you make them for the digital space,
yeah,
because imagery is all good.
Yes, right.
Yeah.
That looks good. But mm-hmm. but then you see people go way overboard.
Absolutely.
I seen a flyer one time, and I was like, are these African delegates? What is going on? Like, it looked like every country in Africa was represented on this little bitty flyer. And it was like,
couldn't figure out what it was for.
And then it had all the names. I said, okay, enough is enough. You know? Right.
That's why people need to hire someone. And then this is worldwide known right now. People need to hire people who are good at what they do, so that they don't let themselves look like J-asses.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
For real. If you know somebody that does flyers, you know somebody that does paperwork, you know somebody that does articles, whatever, hire them to do it. Get somebody that loves to do that so that they can do it at maximum height.
Know what you need to delegate out.
You can't do everything.
That's right.
Like, I'm not a video person. I'll hire a video person in a minute because I just can't sit there and go frame to frame to frame. I'd rather somebody that loves doing video to do it. You know what I'm saying? Because it takes me 10 times longer. Sometimes you just need to spend that money, get it done, and make that investment, because what you get from it is so much bigger.
Right? I'm glad you said that, because looking at the list, it can be overwhelming if you're not tech savvy.
Absolutely.
So I'm like, okay, I need to have my 13-year-old do 1, 2, 3, 5, 6, you know. They know how to do all that stuff.
Yeah. Kids are very, very, they learn very fast. Uh-huh. And utilize them for what they do, you know.
Ain't that it?
Yeah, kids love social media. We don't know nothing about social media. Put them on it.
Yeah.
Not only are they going to do it at maximum speed, but, I mean, they're going to love doing it because that's their playground.
That's their platform.
Yeah. Is there anything else? What other kind of things researching out there?
Well, we've got virtual augmented reality, which we saw with Pokemon Go this past year.
Right, that was a crazy phase.
It was.
Yeah.
It was really
people. I used to see people in front of my house on their phone, and then they would like come toward my house, and I was just like, "What is going on?" And I come to the door and I'm like, can I help you? And they're like, no, I'm just on Pokemon Go. I'm like, really?
So ain't none of
y'all
play
in my neighborhood catching Pokemon.
Ain't none of y'all play Pokemon at least once.
See, I loved the cartoon when I was a kid, but I mean, this game, it went crazy because people was like everywhere.
I
think somebody ended up getting killed by because they were so into the game.
Listen, I played it once and then I realized I was looking real stupid in that field. So I stopped.
In the field?
Let me stop. Because he was standing behind me, so I was like,
"It's some serious Pokemon Go people out there."
I did it once.
Serious,
it's embarrassing. No.
But I'm not really sure. They didn't have any kind of direction on how you would use it again, like the live streaming, because it's kind of new, I guess you'd say. But I mean, we're seeing that with who is it? Sprint or Verizon now offers the visor. Where you can do the virtual reality.
Yeah. Those are in right now. I think, I mean, it's becoming, see, that's why you have to get ahead. When you're ahead of the curve, you got to enjoy it. Because once they find out it's making money, they're going to overpopulate it and maximize on it. And then and your product becomes like virtually nothing.
Yep. Listen, he even hit the nail on the head. Mm-hmm. So when I got involved in social media, it was 2011, right? So a few of my platforms I use now were in beta.
Yeah.
Anytime something in beta, sign get up it. For it.
Right.
Even if you don't use it, just sign get up it. For it.
Mm-hmm.
So, mind you, I was surprised when I went to sign up Hootsuite for a new client.
Mm-hmm.
And the price that they shot up on that screen, I was like, I need to call Hootsuite because...
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
What the world? You're getting money on it. I'm going to have my beta one for the rest of my life.
Yeah,
I'm
absolutely.
A beta Hootsuite.
Grandfathered in. Yeah.
I mean, so, you know, when you're ahead of the curve, you find that stuff in beta, oh, my God. Because once people adapt it,
yeah,
I'm like, I swear to God, MailChimp do that to me. We're going to have a fight at MailChimp.
Yeah.
I'm relying on MailChimp.
See, I must be behind the curve because this is like Spanish.
I was going to say, what's Hootsuite?
I'm going to say, like, I understand. So we're behind the curve.
Right. Yeah. I'm okay with that.
Okay. So Hootsuite is probably your best friend when it comes to social media scheduling.
It is Hootsuite.
Hootsuite.
Hootsuite. Mm-hmm. Okay.
It takes, if I'm correct, it takes like all your apps like Facebook, Instagram, and you could post from one, and it goes to all of them.
Yeah, well, you can just manage them all from one spot, so you can, you know, you see all your fees there. The old, like my beta was free up to 5 accounts, but now you only get 3. But so you can manage it for free up to 3 accounts, and you know, you can schedule posts. You can do a bulk upload to where you can schedule 300 messages for the month.
Wow.
You know, it's a really good tool, especially for those self-employed, one-person entrepreneurs.
Yeah.
It really takes a lot of time off your hand. Because let's be honest, we have to be on social media.
Yes.
Let me say that again.
Yeah.
We have to be on social media.
Absolutely.
I hear so many people tell me, I'm not on social media. I'm like, skirt. You just lost out on like all your audience, dude. I mean, regardless.
You definitely reach people that you would not have reached before.
Reach.
If anything, utilize it for what it's for. It's to reach people.
Look, it's funny. So I have to tell my Kevin Bacon story, huh?
Yeah.
Yes.
Go ahead.
You do. So I was at a conference one time, and this is the power of social media, right? I was at a social media dames conference. I was talking with other women. So the woman that spoke before me, she was talking about the 6 Degrees organization, right?
Okay.
And she was like, well, all you have to do is send them a tweet, and they'll either retweet or they'll, you know, Kevin Bacon will show up or another celebrity. So me being as cynical as I am, like, yeah, right. Okay. I tweeted. I was like... hey, have you heard about Pitchfeast? It's a really cool event. And then I included a video for them to watch. And so within 10 minutes, I got a response back. And it was like, that's really cool. We want to talk. I was like, oh. And I mean, from that point on, you know, Kevin Bacon was here for the state fair, but he was coming in town, so he wanted to acknowledge a nonprofit. So I was able to connect with him through that tweet, and he donated $500 to my organization.
Nice.
Yeah, and then he threw breakfast. He threw breakfast over.
That's incredible. Never underestimate social media.
The power of a tweet. Like, it's you don't know who's looking at you.
Oh, yeah.
You have to look at the trend. See, we don't, like, if you're not a business owner, then you can't really catch that kind of stuff. If some business owners don't catch it as well, but I'm going to give you a key. When you see Facebook and social media making updates, and all of a sudden you see sponsor ads, and you got to pay attention to those because those are keys to what's happening next. And we like just scrolling, like, man, whatever.
And that same ad just keep chasing you all the time.
It sure does.
You see it 5 times.
But you be like, fuck it.
But subliminally, when you go, you're good.
Okay. I was going to Target.
Subliminally, right.
Real smart women, cuz. Sorry. Yeah.
So I don't know if y'all have noticed this too. So, like, say you're searching Google for something, you're looking for a product, and then you log into your email, and that product's right on the side. You're like, man, I was just looking for that.
That's
so
a chatbot.
Is that Cache?
That's AdSense.
Yep. That's Cache.
There's multiple different ones now.
Is that the same thing as
chatbots? I can't remember.
Okay.
Whatever it is, it's a part of
basically.
I forgot what it was called. Some guy told me what it was. I wish I could remember. But basically, you pay them, and they force feed your whatever you look at on Google. They force feed it to all your over your computer on everything you look at, whether it's your email, whether it's another website, anywhere there's an ad on that website, you're going to see whatever you were searching for.
Yeah.
So those things right there, very, very smart advertisements.
Irritating, but smart.
Not only that, who's the Sisters of Savings?
Hair Chevrolet.
Courtney.
Look. Hair Chevrolet. Yeah.
Exactly. See, that advertisement, if you notice, they hit every holiday.
Wait a minute. Who's at 96th Street in
Hague
Road?
There it is. So if you're going to go look for a car, where you going to go? You're going to go to the Sisters of Savings. Because see, the thing is like, if you look at like Ken Nunn, everybody know who Ken Nunn, right? He's a lawyer. They do the same ads over and over. They just find a new theme.
Yeah, they do.
So when people slightly annoying.
Exactly. You know? Yeah, Roush. Right. I mean, come on. I mean, I know so many of them just live in Indianapolis. If I want to go somewhere, I'm looking at that first.
Yeah.
You know, when I get to Google, I'm putting in something I heard before.
Yeah.
You know, so, you know, people got to take advantage of that.
It's that consistent messaging.
Absolutely.
That you always hear. Shane Company is the one company.
Absolutely. Shane Company.
So growing up consistent. With yes. Shane Company.
They have
in your
never
ear.
Changed.
Right.
The voice has been
right.
the same.
Right.
Consistent
Shane Company.
Messaging. Yeah. So that, guess what I want when I go get a ring?
Shane Company.
Shane.
See,
Diamond,
and we have
Diamond
to,
Company.
As business owners, we have to take advantage of what mm-hmm. they're doing because it works.
Absolutely.
They're doing it over and over and over again.
Consistent.
Look at music marketing. You know, at some level, the music is being paid to get played on the radio at some
right,
point.
Right.
So you have to look at the amount of times that they play a song that you think is dumb. You know, by the next month and a half, you done listen to the radio. Now this is your favorite song.
Singing it.
You see what I'm saying?
Singing
it's
it.
Advertisement, you know. So, again, advertisement is a big deal. Invest in it. People, don't be cheap. You're going to spend that money some form of fashion on marketing, and let that be one of them.
Amen, because marketing is sales.
Oh, yeah.
Marketing is sales.
Marketing is sales. It does
one
equate to sales.
Marketing is sales.
It does equate to sales. Absolutely. And I've done that too. When I was an artist, I used to, I got on Comcast and I requested a quote to see how much my music would be played on certain outlets. Mm-hmm. You know, I got a lady mad at me because my commercial played on Nickelodeon. This is outrageous. Inbox me. She found me and was mad that video. I was like, look, that's not my fault. Comcast put that on there. They told
like,
me.
That was the cheap time.
They
slot.
Told me. Yeah. They told me that it would play on Nickelodeon. So I ain't got no control over that.
That's all I'm looking for.
But I was just happy because it was effective in my eyes.
Yeah.
That people were reaching out to me. Somebody reached out. I was watching ESPN and your video came on. I'm like, wow, that's amazing. You know, people feel like you've arrived when they seen you on TV, but really you're just purchasing marketing yourself and, you know, spending that money to purchase ads and stuff. And it's doing what it's supposed to do. It's reaching the people that it needs to reach.
Mm-hmm. And so, that is a good point. But also, just be sure that you are on the platforms that you're ready for.
Right. Absolutely.
You know, I've seen people invest money into things that they probably shouldn't invest it in just yet.
Right,
I mean,
right.
So your advertising grows as your business grows.
Understand your demographic.
You know, understand your demographic. Going back to that, do a lot of research in terms of who your target market is.
Mm-hmm.
I always encourage people when they get started to even find out what that NAICS number is.
Yeah.
Because once you know that number, then you can find out everything you need to know about your industry first.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And then you can find out who's buying from your industry.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
Absolutely.
Tell us what that is.
Research.
Break that down.
So the NAICS number, I don't know what that acronym stands for. Probably something real long or something. They didn't want us to find this. I guarantee you.
Mm-hmm.
But there's a website. What is it called? I just drew
what does that have to do with? I look it up right now while you're talking about it.
It is it's a market research reports.
Okay. In Indianapolis?
IBIS. That's what it is. Sorry. So the IBIS research reports. If you are a student in college, then you can normally get these on your campus for free. Mm-hmm. These research reports cost about $1,200 to $1,300 each, but they break down everything you need to know in your industry from the money. That the revenues that's projected for the next 3 to 5 years, the people, your activities that's included in that actual industry, and then those people who will be buying from your industry, and those people you'll be buying from. So it's good to know because there are some industries where there's some overlap. You know, sometimes you find people in, I guess, catering. And food service might be two different things.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Or catering in restaurants.
Yeah.
So you have someone who really has an idea to be a caterer, but he's looking at a building to get a restaurant.
Wow.
Maybe you're a caterer.
Right.
So they take what you do and they say, hey, based on what you do, this is your demographic and this is what's happening in that area.
No, actually, IBIS World has a list of every NAICS number in the world. So this is not even domestic, it's global as well.
Oh, wow.
So, I mean, from pig farming to selling cow manure. There's an NAICS code for it. Wow. And so, for instance, if you are in a babysitter, you can go to Google and you can say, what is my NAICS code for babysitting? Right. And it'll give you a 5-digit code.
Okay.
And that's the code that you want to look at because you want to know who's looking for babysitters. So you can Google this information.
Right.
You can go to SBA.org.
Okay.
Because they have a lot of information there. Or if you can get hold of an IBIS World Report, it is wonderful.
That's awesome.
And as you see,
IBISWorld.com. Wow. Yeah. IBISWorld, WORLD.com.
And you see their tagline is knowledge is power. It is absolutely amazing in terms of the things we've been able to figure out helping people by using these reports. Wow. You know, you've been able to transition folks,
right?
You know, you've been able to help them understand, okay, what are your activities? Because I'm sure you've talked to people and you've asked them, what do you do? And they're so vague, you're like,
is that it?
So you can say, okay, does it follow along this?
Right.
You know, so it's really a good way for you to understand the industry you're in, and then for people like us who help, it's good for us to understand putting them in that industry,
right?
Where they
need
and I'm sure that helps with creating a vision.
Oh my God.
Or just knowing, you know, where you are, where you fit in. Now you know where you can.
And these are helpful for like business plans as well.
Oh my God. So one thing about business plans, they're dead. They.
Okay.
You want a pitch deck.
Okay.
Say that again.
You want a pitch deck.
Pitch deck.
What's pitch deck?
Okay. So a pitch deck is basically, it consists of about 9 slides. For the most part, they're done on a PowerPoint.
Okay.
So when you talk to an investor these days, they're going to ask you for your pitch deck.
Okay.
They're not going to ask for business plans.
Gotcha.
And a pitch deck just basically asks about 9 essential questions about your business.
Okay.
Who are your key partners? What is the value proposition? You know, what do you do?
Right.
What are your activities? What is the cost?
Mm-hmm.
What are your revenues?
Mm-hmm.
Who's your target? What's that relationship? So it makes you really focus on, how am I going to put this together?
Right. Mm-hmm.
Who's going to help me put this together? How much is it going to cost me?
Mm-hmm.
How much am I going to make? And I encourage everyone to Google the Business Model Canvas. You can look that up.
The Business Model Canvas?
Uh-huh.
Okay.
You can find that on Google. They come with free templates. But they are really good. I use business model canvases from from business ideas to doing a project at my house sometimes because they are really good at just helping you start strategically. And then the one word I love is lean.
Hmm.
So you're not wasting a lot of resources.
Wow, so they walk you through everything.
Step by step.
There's a website called liveplan.com.
And so the Business Model Canvas was created by Steve Blanks. He is a professor at Stanford University. So you might even be able to find like those open ed courses. You might be able to find the Business Model Canvas on that free Stanford open ed course. But I encourage anyone who's either you're starting a business, are you expanding your business, if you're launching a new product, download a Business Model Canvas. And, you know, you just hone in on those ideas, and you should not have more than 5 to 7 bullet points on each area. And then the good thing is, once you finish your first business plan, you take it, you get out there, you put it into action. What doesn't work, you mark it off, you go to the next one.
Right.
So it kind of helps you stay focused.
Because some people form business plans, and they don't necessarily think it work, or they'll go to a bank and get rejected, and they just give up on it. You know, what do they need to do? Go back to the drawing board and take from those experiences. And, like, if you go to a bank and reject it, find out why.
Absolutely.
And then go correct that.
Absolutely. You know, that's the one good thing about Pitchfeast. We do provide a mentor. And I encourage everyone to get a mentor and get a mentor that's going to be honest with you. You know, someone who is like, look, this does not make sense.
Right.
I would appreciate someone telling me that makes sense before I spent 3 to 4 months into something.
Right.
But, you know, I know sometimes we got our business plans are like our babies and you don't want anybody to molest your baby and mess with your baby. But you have to just put them out there and let that person or whoever you trust just tear it apart.
Right.
You know, if you're serious about it.
Mm-hmm. But, absolutely.
You have a wealth of knowledge in business, but you have a background in history.
I was like, I'm going to get that question in there somewhere.
Right here. So what do you say to people that, because I went to school, my undergrad is in business. And I started a business. I said I learned business from actually being in business versus majoring in business, which seems like that's the best because you have your application versus your theory. And so what do you say to those people who, because I hate to dissuade people that go to school for business to start a business, but it kind of, it almost to me seems like a waste of time sometimes unless you want that accounting, you know, aspect of it. But besides that, you know, it seems like you have actually mastered business without majoring in business.
You know, it's interesting. So I came to understand that business, for the most part, is teaching you business management. So it's teaching you how to work in corporate America and manage people in someone else's business. Whereas entrepreneurship teaches you about identifying a problem and coming up with a solution to solve that problem. So I think that's kind of where... I differ in the realm of business. I consider myself more of an entrepreneur.
Okay.
But then with my history background, it's looking at things in a chronological way.
Gotcha. Wow.
So,
okay.
So they then, all kind of work together.
Yeah,
that's awesome.
I think. That's the story I'm going to stick with. But
it sounds like you have the research from your historical background.
It's important to understand that as well.
Right.
Economically.
Absolutely.
Because you'll drive yourself crazy not understanding what's going on.
Yeah, that is true.
And then sometimes, you know, we have some of us, we have to be at the table and we have to bring that voice of reason to the table. I've sat in, you know, a couple times. There was one conversation I sat in, and this woman, she had done this amazing research, but the premise of her research was that black businesses have not started at the rate of white businesses in the last 100 years. Let me clear my
throat. Clear your throat.
Because I'm about to take off on this horse.
You got some water out there.
And so I asked the question to her. I said, why would you use 100 years? If we go back 100 years from now, this is 1916.
Right.
We know the gates didn't open until 1965. At least it wasn't fair, but we at least got the gate open.
Right.
So why wouldn't you take your research from 1965 until now?
Right.
She couldn't answer the question.
Right.
You know, and you know, to me, you got people out here just publishing things like this.
Right.
Yeah, the numbers are different.
But you're not. It's a big difference, and you're not. But you don't even take that big portion into
consideration.
Yeah, yeah.
So it's just, you know, I think the more I got into it in terms of trying to understand entrepreneurship and how it can help a certain amount of people, then I started seeing different loopholes and, you know, different...
Yeah, that's why it's important to understand the business that you're in.
Right.
Yeah. You know, you can love creating signs, you know, you know, have a passion for it, but know nothing about the business on the back end. You got to go to trade shows. You got to get out there. Understand your business. Yeah. Get out there and, you know, and build rapport with people. Get out there and understand what you do. Do some research on it. Look at the numbers. See how much it costs. Because people won't give you that kind of information.
No.
You know, there's some good people out there that will try and, you know, let you in and help you out. I've seen that happen. One guy told so much information, the dude surpassed him, you know. But but honestly, that's what you want, right? I think all of us want to do that. Like, I love this podcast and what we do and helping people, but I want to see more of them. I want to see more people doing these kind of things because the more of them we have, the better, right? You know, I'm not hoarding anything. I want people to do what I'm doing. And I'm going to try and create a standard at which that they should at least start at. You know, so I think that whatever business field that we're in, we should try and do that.
Right.
You know, because I looked at the other standards and I said, well, I like that, but I want to do it like this. You know, me and my partner, we wiggled in into an area that we knew nothing about. We didn't go to school for this. We didn't, you know, we just seen what people were doing and decided that this local area needed more of this. Right. And we created, you know, something that works for us. Nice. So people need to do that, you know, be a part of the solution and creating something that is not there. Be, you know, fill the void.
And then even taking that a step further, like you said, you mentioned trade shows, you know.
Yep.
Get outside the box and definitely go to some trade shows.
Yeah.
You know, be that only black person.
You can learn so much at trade shows.
You learn so much at trade shows and you meet.
And they're
so
willing to talk to you. The people there didn't pay that fee to sit there for nothing. They want you to know about their business. And they'll do anything to get your business, even tell how their business works.
And you stay ahead of the curve because that's where they announce
new innovations.
So, you know, definitely, you know, I know I see a lot of us, we spend a lot of money on different meet and greets.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Save that, you know, because that's part of your marketing dollars. Mm-hmm. And save that money and make sure you get ROI out of mm-hmm. your marketing dollars, you know.
Yeah.
Everything is not business expendable mm-hmm. if it's, right, if it right. doesn't make sense.
Right. I think there are people, and I commend the people for trying, you know, yeah. We're trying. But be careful at what you get involved with.
Amen.
Because there are people out there that are just doing it for the money.
Amen.
And as soon as they get that dollar, they don't care about what's going on.
That's right.
I had a dude that walked me to the moon to get business on doing the fence at my house. As soon as that fence was done, I ain't heard from him. He was like, yeah, I'm going to come back, check on you, come back, do this and do that. As soon as he got that check, boy, he was out of there. I said, dang, man. But so you got to, you know, and hey, he did what he had to do. You know what I'm saying? Ain't nothing wrong with that. But, you know, if you want a successful business, follow up with people. Mm-hmm. See how they're doing. See what's going on. Because there's people doing way more than you. Mm-hmm. And they're not spending a dime. It doesn't cost a dime to send a thank you card or
right.
a follow-up card or something. You know, you'll be amazed that person says, hey, you know, nobody's ever sent me a follow-up card.
That's right.
I'm going to go ahead and, you know, recommend them as a great business.
Right.
So it's those little things. Little mm-hmm. things we got to think about, you know, that people do for us. You
That's
know,
right.
it goes a long way. So yeah. What else we got here? I think it's here.
I had another question
go ahead.
About Pitchfeast.
Okay.
With young people, can you give us just kind of an idea of what some of, for the young people that are listening, some things that they have actually pitched at the Pitchfeast?
Oh, yeah. So we have had some young dreamers mm-hmm. pitch. So we had a program on at Tech High School a couple years ago, and the kids were putting together some ideas. So we had a pitch feast geared towards them. And mm-hmm. so the winner of that, he was creating an edible bug food.
Edible bug food.
Okay.
Mm.
So he was actually doing a lot of research because it was interesting. He found that although, you know, you see in underdeveloped countries, you see a lot of malnourished children and whatnot.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
On the flip side, there are people who are nourished.
Mm-hmm.
Well, because they eat different local bugs.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So he was saying it's a perception thing as to why Americans would eat bugs.
Okay.
So mm-hmm. he was trying to look, and he was actually doing really good research trying to figure out which bugs that we would consider edible, and then he wanted to create a vending machine that Aww. Basically people can get these edible
wow.
bugs out of. So he
you can't knock them.
Interesting.
It was interesting. I mean, he had done
that's
such
a niche.
Yeah. He had done such elaborate research. It was kind of like, go ahead.
Yeah, that's innovation for you.
And so then last year we were up at Westfield High School, and we had about six kids there. Ended up with three winners. So we had to split the money three ways, but. I mean, they did the best in terms of just researching the problem, you know, coming up with a really good solution. They try to understand what was going on in their school and mm-hmm. come up with a solution mm-hmm. to combat that. So, I mean, I've really been amazed by
some of these techniques.
Kids.
Yeah.
These
yeah.
young kids, they
young
are really understanding and they're really seeing the problems that their classmates are dealing with.
Mm-hmm. Right. Mm-hmm.
And so they're trying to come with solutions. There's one guy over at Park Tutor. Mm-hmm. He is actually working with Indie Parks and he's creating an app.
Mm-hmm.
And the app, because he knows that although people are in poverty, they have smartphones.
Mm-hmm. Right.
So he is creating an app that they can use for the summer food program. So
mm-hmm.
basically they can just push that thing, and if they're somewhere in the area where there's a food program,
yep.
they can
oh,
go right there
idea.
And get the food.
That's smart.
That's awesome. Yeah.
These are kids.
Yeah.
Wow.
So
the people don't give out enough coupons. I mean, like, the people who do give out coupons, they've always given out coupons. But, you know, I want to support local business. You know, I think that, and I'm not a free kind of person,
mm-hmm.
but I think that, you know, look at what you're doing at Walmart. People take coupons at Walmart, and they, you know, they want the best deal.
Right.
You know, my girlfriend, she will argue for 30 cents in a heartbeat. I'm trying to tell you. I mean, if it was on the shelf, if it was on the shelf.
Listen, I gonna take a picture of that mug. Hold on.
I do too.
Look, you gonna wait?
If it was on the shelf for $1.30,
right?
and she gets it for any more than that, whether it's 1-2 cents over, she is throwing a fit. Mm-hmm. And I'm talking about she getting that money. Yeah. Okay, she getting that 3 cent, whatever it is. But people take that serious. So people need to figure out how to give out coupons. A good friend of mine, Mike Ford, he has a we train with Mike Ford .com. He has a training program where he gets on places like Groupon and other different platforms, and he puts coupons out there. He gets amazing business from everywhere, leads from everywhere.
Yeah.
You'll be amazed that places like Retail Me Not, and there's so many different online businesses that you can utilize to put your coupons on, because they just manufacture ads that send these coupons out to people.
They really do.
You'll never, I mean, it just makes you official as well. It's like a flyer. It's like, wow, this person's local business is next to Subway, McDonald's. Take advantage.
Yeah.
Take advantage.
Let me give your girlfriend a tip, right? So if it rings up wrong, then she goes back to customer service. She's supposed to get it for free.
Oh, is she? Where at?
Normally on the U-Scan. So most of the scans, it's a scan, something, scan right. It's called the scan right law or something.
Oh, wow.
It doesn't work on alcohol.
That's in Indiana?
It's in Indiana. Oh, so if it rings up wrong, you look at that receipt, you'd be like, thank you. Go right over to customer service.
She don't need to know that. That's a whole other. I'll be pulling her out of the store. Baby, come on. It's only 20 cents. Come on.
She's like, no, this one's free, baby. This one's free.
It's a big deal. It's a big deal. People need to build rapport more. Mm-hmm. I don't think that we build with each other enough. I think you mentioned being careful about meetups and groups and stuff. To me, a lot of this stuff should be voluntary. We shouldn't be charging people to meet up with us and help them understand business. For one, somebody who don't understand business is not really going to pay a lot of money to go try to understand something that they can't take away.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? You can take away some things. Like, and I'll use this for example. There are people that come in this city, and they come here quite frequently to sell real estate. Mm-hmm. Like in programs, packages. It's free to get in. You sit in there, and by the time you get done, it all sounds great, but you don't leave with anything.
Right.
You leave like dumb as be when you got there. But you know, they found ways to bring you back and to have you pay for it. You know, so that, I mean, that's an interesting thing, because I mean, it's almost worth paying for if you know that it's effective and works. Mm-hmm. But you can't have a meetup or a greeting and it's not effective. Mm-hmm. You know, what you do is effective. Mm-hmm. You've done it several different times. People come, they pay money, they walk away with money, mm-hmm. you know, and it supports their business. It helps them out a whole lot. Yeah. So we need to individually create more success like that for people. Create more ways without having them spend a whole ton of money. Well, you know, because the money's going to come, right? So I think if you're passionate about something, that the money's going to come on the back end of that. Be passionate about it first. Love and care for the people that you're doing it for. And then that money's going to come later on. So don't make money your main motive. You know, I think that'll come. Yeah, I think that'll come in the end.
And then Pitchfeast also makes entrepreneurship communal. Mm-hmm. Because you're bringing in people from all aspects of the community.
Right.
And so even if they're not business savvy or interested in starting their own business, they feel like they've contributed.
Oh, kids even want a token.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they want to vote. My son wants a vote.
Yeah.
You know, they want to be part of it.
So the people who are eating, mm-hmm. you know, who are at the tables, everybody gets a voting token.
Get a token to vote, yep.
Right.
So everyone that pays to get in gets a token to vote.
They get a token, and then they, is it at the end when they, well, how do you collect the tokens?
We have like a 20-minute networking session.
Okay.
A networking session, I should call it. Right. Where they basically just talk to each other, mingle, and then they do the votes. Right. And then we come back, we count the votes, and then come back and announce the winner.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's incredible.
Thank you. Yes, it's fun.
That's ingenious.
It is. I've never heard of it.
That's
why,
you know, it's so crazy. If I showed you a picture of my first pitch, I'd be like, it's like watching somebody about to have a heart attack on stage.
Wow.
It's like, how did I get
trying to figure it out?
So it's just, helping people to step Right. That next level.
Just but over time, like, you kept doing it, and now it's just something that's normal.
Oh, yeah. 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 Oh, my God. Like, when somebody say, tell me about Pitchfeast, I automatically go into elevator mode. Like, Pitchfeast
is it. Well, tell us about your first pitch for Pitchfeast.
That's funny. So, that's when I had, the first time I had pitched just for the center. Mm-hmm. I was at IUPUI still. Mm-hmm. And so, that's when you can see that live heart attack on YouTube. But I was pitching when I first had my idea about putting together a center to help African-American entrepreneurs.
Yep.
I was pitching in front of the audience at the student pitch competition. Mm-hmm. So we had all the, you know, chancellors and stuff in the front row and all the fun stuff in the back. And I got up there and I don't know what happened, but I couldn't
froze up
everything, like
locked up.
I'm still locked up, like, now. I just remember thinking, like, Lord, please just swallow me now. Just open the ground and swallow me, Lord. I'll be okay. Just swallow me. So then I finally came through. It just didn't go well. What ended up, there was a guy named Derek there, and he was with Dreamapolis. Dreamapolis had just got started. So we kind of had synergy. It was like, oh, you're doing the same thing. Let's kind of marry the idea.
Right.
That's where the partnership came in. So since then, Derek and Ian Giron, who was part of Dreamapolis, they've gone. They moved. Derek moved to Cincinnati, and Giron moved to California. Mm-hmm. And so it's just been.
But wow! But you still holding it down.
Still holding it down.
Something that you got locked up on. When did you start feeling comfortable with your product?
With Pitchfeast. So it was interesting. I came around 2012. We did our first pitch. They did the first Pitchfeast event in 2011. October 2011, that was the first one. Yep. So when I came along, that's when we started doing them consistently. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So when I came along, I was kind of like behind the scenes, serving food, running around.
Mm-hmm.
I was good with that. We had another volunteer, and then he was like, I can't do this anymore, so kind of just thrust me in the front. Wow. Like, okay.
So you had to take it.
Sing or swim.
Yeah.
Right. And then by then, my partners, they had gone, so it was just me. Mm-hmm. I just jumped up there, you know. It took a minute, but I just got used to it.
You jumped off the ledge. And it worked out.
Yeah, and I just still don't understand how, you know, because public speaking was not something I was trying to do at all.
Right, right.
Just kind of.
I think everybody has a gift that they're, like, granted when they're born, and it's all about, like, finding it. Sometimes you need to be pushed into it to realize that that's kind of what you should be doing.
That's a good way to put that.
Yeah.
That was good.
Yeah.
It sounds like you do have a knack for, like, this is your passion, the way you talk about it.
Yeah.
Which, you know, you can really tell if it seems like that you enjoy it. Success. Yeah, you enjoy it. It's not just a job. Because a lot of times entrepreneurs or business owners, they have, like, it turns into a job, like a chore that they hate.
It's not fun anymore.
Right, it's not fun. Right. So I can tell that it's still fun and exciting, and that actually is a draw in and of itself for people to be wanting to be a part of it.
Thank you. Yeah. Well, you know, it's interesting. So when I was little, and I guess, again, I think once I took away the glorification of entrepreneurship in terms of Bill Gates and all that, when I was little, my mom, my both of my grandmothers, my aunt, you know, they all clean houses for a living. So what did we call them? The cleaning lady. Yeah. We didn't know they were entrepreneurs. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? Like, my mama had a hustle. You know what I'm saying? So we got to start. So when you start seeing things like that or understanding things like that, it is kind of exciting.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. You know, because you start understanding there's a freedom that comes with entrepreneurship, to be honest. Definitely.
Absolutely.
There's a freedom, you know, and especially when you're using your inherent talents.
Mm-hmm.
So this is a talent that no one can take from me, you know.
Right. Yeah, you might, and then you get paid for that talent.
And you get paid. You might not to hire me because of this degree, right? This degree might not get me hired, but you're going to hire me because of my skill.
Right. Absolutely.
So, you know, that in itself is kind of like a liberating freedom that kind of makes you a little arrogant sometimes, but it's good.
No, I find that the women, I see a lot of the women in this city, like, really moving and shaking.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Like, I'm almost like, guys, what are we doing? You know, we still talking about the Super Bowl. We still talk about the Colts and the sports. Right. And, like, we really need to get out here and make it happen. Mm-hmm. Because I've seen several events that's going on in this city, and they're being ran by women.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And I love it. You know what I'm saying? But I think the guys definitely need to step up, especially in the African-American community. We need to get our game together and start getting out here and building businesses. People think it's hard to run a business. It really, I mean, like, I'm not going to say it's not hard, but I really feel like they make it harder than what it seems. Because really, like, even if you have a daytime job, I think everybody should have a side business. Like, seriously, if you live in this country and you pay taxes, you should have a side business. Because there's so many things that come with that. like, you get a lot of tax breaks. Yeah, I'm just going to use Donald Trump for one. I don't know how he got rid of that money. But
that's not a tax break. That's a tax erasure.
Right. But what I'm saying is like you have to be able to survive, right? Mm-hmm. And a lot of times, if you're surviving on just your income, you might be paycheck to paycheck. So if you got a business, and all the government wants to know is what you're doing with your money. Mm-hmm. So if you're not showing the government that you're at least trying to build a business or do anything with your money that's productive for the economy, they're going to tax you. So at the end of the day, get you a side business, whether you do hair, whether you do taxes, whatever you do, get you a hustle and get it in documentation. And then when that time comes to do taxes, if you had a lot of losses, put them losses on there.
That's right,
because that's going to curve the money. So you could have made $40,000, $50,000, but only spent $25,000 of that. Right. Because the rest of it went to you driving across the state and meeting with people and all that. Mm-hmm. All these meetings, all this like meet up, greet up. You should be ticking these receipts, logging them.
Mileage, 55.
Mileage, everything is accounted for when you have a side business. And even some states, they allow you to use your social security number and pick a business and then say, hey, and Indiana's one of them. You can absolutely say that, hey, this is my social. I was a contractor. I don't have a 1099, but I want to file a Schedule C. Put all of your information in there that you use to do that business and send it. Absolutely. I mean, I've seen it done over and over and over again. So anybody that's trying to start a business, do not give up on that. Mm-hmm. Absolutely go out there and create. Get you, Secretary of State, get your tax ID.
Yeah.
File it.
$90.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. It's worth the investment. It's worth the investment.
That's a myth, too, that starting a business is expensive when it's not.
It's really not.
In Illinois, $30 for a trademark. I mean,
yeah.
Just the fees alone, like the amount of money you spend doing the other things, you actually could be cigarettes if you smoke.
Amen.
You buy cigarettes.
Amen. Like pop, cigarettes are expensive.
Whatever
yeah.
your vices are, you could actually start. People your have to do legally.
Research.
Just by, yeah.
All you got to do is research. You know, we hired Nicole DeAndre, a partner of ours. She helped us get our paperwork together, and I was just amazed that she was able to get me trademarked for like $10.
$10.
Yeah.
I had no idea.
Or we'll pay a lot of
but trademark. If you go to to the trademark websites, you're looking at $250 to $1,000.
Yeah,
and it's really
sheet,
just those are third party companies offering to do this for you,
you
and they're charging you on the back end. Mm-hmm. So I mean you gotta do your research. Yes, I mean there's inexpensive ways to do all this stuff.
It is. I mean even a 501c3 you do it on yourself
you it
by yourself is $400. Whereas an attorney might charge you $5,000.
Exactly. Yeah. Right. Right. You'd be amazed what people charge for, like bankruptcies and all. I mean, like if it's you could do your own research and file your own stuff if you just know it.
Know it. Yeah.
You know, but then you have to pay a lawyer or somebody else like thousands and thousands of dollars to screw your. I mean, to like put your stuff in. And you like, I could have used that on what I owe people.
Yeah. But most of them have step by step instructions on how to do it anyway and what to file and you know all those different documents that you need.
So you're basically paying to do it the right way.
Yes, you are.
Yeah, so, right. You know, that's really what it's time. Which is what you should do if you don't know what you're doing.
Yeah,
you know?
I do understand
Let's
that.
Not get out of that.
that
Well, it has been an honor.
Yes.
And we've had a ball on here. We probably laughed more than we should, but that's just us being us. We are ecstatic that you came to the Gray Area to talk with us about Pitchfeast.
Thank you for having
and
me.
And we're definitely going to bring you back on because we got to keep getting the word out there about this. It's pitchfeast.org.
Yes, and our next event is 227 at the Speakeasy. Doors open at 6:30. The Speakeasy is located at 5255 North Winthrop over in Broadripple.
Okay. There it is.
And wasn't there another event?
Lemonade.
Lemonade Day. You want me to
give us a
Lemonade Day?
Yeah,
tell us about Lemonade Day.
Go ahead, let them know.
Okay, so put my other hat on. in my day job. So I work for the Think Forward Foundation, and we kind of support entrepreneurship amongst children. Mm-hmm. So we look at bringing in entrepreneurial education and curriculum. So one of the things we do is called the Indianapolis in Lemonade Day event. And so Lemonade Day, well, the Lemonade Day initiative is just a free citywide initiative that teaches kids the fundamentals of entrepreneurship and financial literacy by setting up a lemonade stand. So we have a curriculum. They follow the steps, and the curriculum is 14 steps. And then Lemonade Day happens on May 20th. And so they're encouraged to set their stand up on Lemonade Day and just sell.
What day is this again?
May 20th.
May 20th? No, because I was just telling my kids that we're setting up a lemonade stand in the front of the house, and they're going to be working, trying to build their own business.
Go to IndianapolisLemonadeDay.org.
IndianapolisLemonadeDay.
Actually, you can put it on Facebook right there. Go back to Facebook.
Okay. IndianapolisLemonadeDay.org.
Over there on the side.
Hold on. I don't want to lose that. Let me pull this up. IndianapolisLemonadeDay.org.
Yes.
That's the website?
That's the website.
Hold on. Because my kids will be selling lemonade.
The library used to do it. Registration is now open, so you can register your children. We did collaborate with the library this year because in 2015 we went to a digital curriculum and then ended up losing about a 25% participation rate.
Oh, wow.
And so this year we teamed up with the library, and then USA Funds have given us a grant, and we are going to provide 2,500 of the hard physical workbooks for the kids that don't have access to a website. So, yep, there you go right there. You can register.
Nice.
May 20th.
Okay. All right. They're going to be selling lemonade this summer. It's on.
That's right.
So this tells them about the overhead and all that on the expenses and everything.
It walks them through everything from planning
They'll enjoy that.
To finding the site to getting an investor, paying their investor back. And then the mode of Lemonade Day is to spend some, share some, and save some. So the kids are encouraged to spend some of their money.
Right.
Well, profit. Spend some of their profit, save some of their profit, and then share some of their profit.
Nice.
And so since Lemonade Day in Indianapolis has started 2010, so I think they've had like 75,000 kids who participated.
Wow.
The dollar amount I can't come off right now, but the money that's been donated back.
They have to bring their own stuff? How does it work?
So they set up a stand. For the most part, a stand is probably going to cost about $25 on average. So for the most part, the kids get the seed money from their parents.
Okay.
And then they pay their parents back from the profits.
Gotcha.
So that's the investment.
Oh, wow.
That's normally the investment.
That is really cool.
Yeah. So you can, it's interesting because we have some locations on there.
Okay.
So some businesses have teamed up with us. Where it says your stand, go down and bring your stand.
Let me see where that
is. Yeah. Some businesses have teamed up with us and, you know, have opened up their doors for the kids to set up in front of their place.
Nice. I'm missing. Where is
it's at the top. Up there where it says your stand.
Okay.
Right there.
Brand your stand?
Yep.
Okay.
And so that should take you to the link that has, go back down. Go back up to your stand location, sorry.
Okay.
And maybe I should click on that. How to find a stand location.
Okay. Got it. Indianapolis.lemonade.org/stand. Where can I find? Okay.
So yeah, that's basically teaching kids K through 5, kind of introducing them to the concepts of entrepreneurship.
This is really nice.
And then they also get to, you know, host their stand. And then the good thing is, although the Lemonade Day for the city is May 20th, you know, kids still set up their stand throughout the year.
Right.
This Saturday there were some kids up north, Brooks School. They had set up a stand and raised money for their student council. So
that's incredible.
Mm-hmm.
We'll be doing that.
There you go. Sign up.
Again, this has been incredible. Learned tons of stuff, talked about tons of stuff, and this is not it. We're definitely gonna be talking about business again.
Awesome.
This is an ongoing discussion that we want to keep having.
Okay.
I'll let you go first. We usually do closing remarks where we talk to the people and let them know, you know, what they can be, what they can do, you know, the whole nine. Give it to them.
If you can believe it, you can achieve it.
There it is.
Yeah, that's it. If you can
believe it, you can achieve it.
Yeah, I mean, the world is really our oyster, to be honest. Mm-hmm. You know,
it's our canvas, drawing board.
Your own limitation is yourself. So, you know, we have to stop benchmarking ourselves against other people.
Mm-hmm. Right.
You are your own success.
Yeah.
Find success within you and just go with it. But
absolutely. You know. Leslie?
I probably would say as a consumer, you are an entrepreneur too. So think like an
entrepreneur
when you're out there consuming. Because a lot of us don't think about it. We just go out and buy. We don't really think about our purchases or what we're going after. So
that's awesome.
Think more like an entrepreneur.
Absolutely. That's incredible. Ebony?
I would leave with just to cast the net, you know, follow that vision through. A lot of times we, you know, when it gets a little difficult, like you could have stopped, you know, sounds like a few times, you know. But,
I was on the bridge. Right. I was about to jump.
But you kept going. We don't have that stick-to-itiveness, you know, in our community. So just to have that stick-to-itiveness. And some of us kind of, you know, think we can do it all by ourselves. And we got that pride thing. We can't ask for help.
Right,
you know?
Right, right.
So I think that I want to encourage everybody to pitch, you know, and to contact you.
Absolutely.
Because I wish this is something I would have known, you know, many years ago when I had great ideas. I wish when I was a child and I had business ideas that I knew you. So, you know, just want to put that out there to link up with each other and use the resources we have in our community and ask for help to
get the word out.
Yeah.
Can I just add one more thing?
Absolutely. Go ahead.
It was interesting. You said when you was a child, you had all these ideas. And one thing that we do know is creativity is killed.
Yes.
Creativity has been killed. Entrepreneurship comes from creativity. So I was a kid, and when we had, I'm gonna age myself, we got our VCR for the first time. My mama wanted to kill me because I took her VCR apart because I just wanted to know where that tape went. Like, it went in there. I just got to see where it went. Or I used to try to shut the refrigerator and try to figure out when that light was shut. So you know when you got a kid who's kind of entrepreneurial.
Right.
You know you got a kid that's critical in his thought. So kind of feed
the bear.
That. Yeah, feed the bear. Encourage that kid to ask questions or to explore.
Yeah.
Right.
Don't kill that creativity.
Right.
So it's good that you recognize that even as a kid that you had those dreams.
That's awesome. Yeah. That's absolutely awesome. Love it. I'm going to close this by saying thanks to the viewers and those who chime in. We love y'all. Y'all are faithful to us. Y'all like to share our feed and stay tuned in and just keep supporting us. And we sincerely appreciate that at the Gray Area. I just want to also say to all the entrepreneurs and business heads out there, keep going. And if you haven't jumped into the business arena, get in it, because it's a big world and there's plenty to do, plenty to make. The world is your canvas. This is it's there for you for the taking. You know what I'm saying? So don't give up and don't let people tell you that you can't do it.
That's right.
There's a lot of people who will think your idea is bananas and it doesn't make any sense. You know, all that matters is that it makes sense to you. So if you like selling hot dogs, go sell hot dogs.
That's right.
Okay? Go sell them hot dogs. All kinds of different ones.
Hot dog vendor there is.
All right. And make sure y'all visit our website, www.thegrayareamedialive.com. Make sure y'all share our page at the Gray Area Media. Like it. Tell your friends about it. And we'll see you guys soon. Thank you.
Welcome to the Gray Area. The Gray Area Media. We've obligated ourselves to be the voice for all communities, speaking on topics that include community, religion, education, politics, technology, sports, health, and wellness. The Gray Area Media is a platform created by longtime friends for the sole purpose of providing our communities with the ability to voice current, past, and modern day issues. The Gray Area and its naming significance solely speaks to the area in which people shy away from speaking because of media-based constraints or contractual-based obligations. Well, I'm here to tell you, we don't do that here. So please, stay tuned in. We're going to go live in a few minutes. Don't forget, please add us as a friend on Facebook so that you can follow our live feed. And not only that, please add us on Twitter and Instagram. at The Gray Area Media. Please visit our website at www.thegrayareamedialive.com. Thank you.